being he was clothed in divine wisdom, which made their wisdom foolishness. Hallelujah. Our text this morning shares how Jesus focused his attention on the treasure. The holy account gives us a picture of Jesus' concern for the treasury of the house of the Lord. Amen. Jesus said, and you've heard this before, I'm repeating it. Jesus said more about stewardship than any other subject. Because stewardship is a heavenly investment. Can you say it with me? Heavenly investment. Matthew 6, verses 19 through 34. Turn with me into your Bibles. Turn with me. If you have that, and you can put it on the screen if you can. Matthew chapter 6, 19 through 34. This is the word of God. Jesus said, lay not up for yourselves treasures upon earth, where moth and rust doeth corrupt, and where thieves break through and steal. Jesus said, but lay up for yourselves what? Treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt, and where thieves can serve two masters. For either he will hate the one, said, is not the life more than meat, and the body that neither do they reap, nor gather into barns. Yet your heavenly Father can add one cubit unto his stature. Short in stature. Do you remember the platform shoes? They would get them platforms and give them some height. But Jesus said, which of you, by taking thought, can add one cubit unto a stature? And why take you thought for raiment? Question. Therefore, take no thought, saying, what shall we eat? Or what you have need of all these things. The Lord already knows what you need. Look at someone and tell them, God already knows what I need. Oh, hallelujah. He knows you need your bills paid. He knows you need gas in your car. He knows you're going to need food. But Jesus said, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Take therefore no thought for tomorrow, for the morrow shall take thought for the thief. That's how people gain. He is concerned today. Sometimes we feel we are only giving to a church budget. But this is not so, church. This is not the preacher's church. This is the Lord's church. Everything in this church belongs to the Lord. He is the head of the church. And the head of the treasury. When we give to further the gospel of Jesus Christ. Give God glory in the house. The gospel of Mark 12:41 gives us an account of how Christ beheld how the people cast money. The Greek translation for beheld means one looking at a thing with interest and for a purpose. Usually indicating the careful observation of details. So in this passage of scripture, Jesus saw the rich cast in much out of their abundance. And he witnessed the poor widow as she gave her little. Jesus not only noticed those who gave, but he also noted the amount of each gift. Yes. Now, please listen carefully here. Look at your neighbor and say, put your list He did not condemn them. Now make no mistake about it. I would love to have a couple millionaires in this congregation. Brother Mike, are you okay with me? I'd love to have a couple of millionaires join this church. Thank God for those who make a lot of money and give a lot. All it does is help to further the gospel. People ought to make all the money they can, as long as they make it honestly. Amen. God is able to bless people to do the best they can in their area of business. God is able. But hear me closely. Possessing possessions is not wrong until possessions begin to possess us. Do I need to say that again, Mom? Possessing possessions is not wrong until possessions begin to possess us. Throughout the Bible, we find the Lord being pleased with the gifts of those who love Him. How many love the Lord? Genesis 8, verse 20 gives us the account of how Noah built an altar unto the Lord and took of every clean beast and every clean fowl and offered burnt offerings on the altar. Genesis 8 and 21 tells us that the Lord was pleased with Noah's gift. Hallelujah. When the Lord commanded the building of Moses, all the offering which the children of Israel and all the wise men that brought on, this is what I love. The people bring much more than enough for the service of the work. Playing throughout the camp, saying, let neither man nor woman make any more work for y'all. He had to tell them, we have enough. The portions he gave. He looked beyond the hand to the heart. He looked beyond the hand to the heart. Because she gave all she had. My Lord and my God. She gave a sacrificial offering. Even though there were large gifts put into the treasury, Jesus pointed out the one who gave the largest proportion. Now, let's think a little bit here. Suppose she had said, my gift is so small it'll never be any good. Don't bother putting it in. They'll never, I'm not going to put it in. If she had not gave, and she would have thought to herself, it will not be missed. I'm going to just keep it to myself. Now, I truly believe we all know the answer. If she had not given this, she would have missed the Lord's commendation. He gave her a commendation that was worthy to be written in the holy book, in the holy canon, which is the Word of God. That was put in there for us to understand. Jesus pointed out the one who gave the largest proportion, all she had. I tell you the truth this morning. In order to be blessed, you must first trust God and give. Yeah. I wish I had got some hand claps on that. Hallelujah. John chapter 6 tells us that Jesus went across Lake Galilee, also known as Lake Tiberias. The Bible tells us a great crowd of people followed him because they saw the miraculous signs he did, healing the sick. Jesus went up on the side of the hill and sat there with his followers. Bible says it was almost. He said to Philip, "Where can we buy enough bread for all these people to eat?" Put in our terminology. He asked Philip the question just to test him. Philip right then should have said, "Well, Lord, you are my provider. You're able." Philip answered, "We would all have to work a month to buy enough bread for each person here. Not for your blessing. Give me glory for your blessing. Don't take your blessings away. God bless you. God bless you. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. If he heals your body, give God praise. If he makes a way out of no way, give God praise. If he touches you, give God praise. If he protects you from a bad accident, give God praise. If he says, oh, hallelujah." I went around and shook a few hands this morning, and each one I shook, their head, they said, "I don't feel well this morning. I'm aching past. I don't feel good." I'm going to tell you right now, you that told me that, I want to lift your hand and give God glory right now. Yes! Praise me! Hallelujah. The devil would love to knock us down. But our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. Bible says they gathered up the pieces that were left. The people had started eating with only 5 loaves of barley bread. But the followers filled 12 large baskets with the pieces of food that were left. Hear me. There is a heavenly investment in stewardship. There is such a blessing in faithfulness. Oh, glory to God. There's a blessing in being faithful unto God. We're working for more than just a blessing here. I'm working so that I can make it into the kingdom of God, into that heavenly home. Lord have mercy. How many of us are still fighting toward heaven? The Bible says the kingdom of God suffered violence. Talk about the benefits they will receive because of stewardship. Because of their stewardship. Oh, the devil said, "The devil don't want me to preach this to you because he knows there's a blessing in it." The devil would not, he don't want me to tell you about giving. Man, there's a blessing in giving. Is there anyone in here that cannot give God? God is our refuge, a very present help. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Philippians 4, verses 4, chapter 4, verses 14 through 19, Paul said, "Notwithstanding ye have well done that ye did communicate with my affliction. Now ye, Philippians, know also that in the beginning of the gospel, when I departed from Macedonia, no church communicated with me as concerning giving and receiving, but all have received of Epaphroditus the things which were sent from you, an odor of sweet smell, a sacrifice acceptable, well pleasing to God." And then Paul wrote, "My God shall supply all your needs." to their account. In other words, they were making a heavenly investment. Church, when we give unto the Lord, it is like opening a credit account with an overwhelming return. Ooh. Key Bank cannot give you a return like God can. TD Bank cannot give you a return like God can. Berkshire cannot give you a return like God can. Trustco cannot give you a return like God can. I believe when we give as God wants us to give, the Lord of the five loaves and two fish will miraculously make those gifts sufficient to meet the needs of the world in need and make what we give more than sufficient for our needs. Give him glory this morning. Second Corinthians 9, verse 6 through 8. But this I say, he which soweth sparingly shall reap also. You know the word. And he which soweth bountifully shall reap. Every man according as he purposed in his heart, so let him give. Not grudgingly. Church of God, there is nothing better than receiving the blessings of the Lord. I asked this already, I'm going to ask it again. How many of you here this morning need a blessing from the Lord? When we give, we acknowledge God's proper position in our lives. Let me say that again. When we give, we acknowledge God's proper position in our lives. Being willing to stand before him with our hands lifted up and our mouth filled with praise. And as we freely open our hands, God releases his blessings. I want us to stand right now. Let me get ready to pray. Last Sunday, I had a little setback. Sunday night, as we was headed to Middletown, but all of that day I was repeating myself and not remembering. And my wife noticed it. I told her, set my watch, honey. She said, your watch is already set. And I turned it off, took it off and said, honey, set my watch. I was doing things, but I wasn't remembering. And on the way to Middletown, she told me, pull over. And we pulled over with the van. And we were driving. And I was driving. She was nervous. And I saw this scared look on her face. And I said, what's the matter with you? She said, I'm all right. See, God, you know, God knows the right one to give me. My wife knows me. She knows me when something's not right. We've been married almost 38 years. She knows me. And when they took me to the hospital, well, when she finally talked me into going, so the Joan was riding with us. She was scared. She was noticing something's wrong with Pastor. She wasn't saying nothing. So let's let you know I'm not making this up because I have a witness. My wife was nervous. I didn't have a clue. I was on my way to another church trying to be a blessing. And we pulled over. Brother George, bless Brother George, he was driving a van. We pulled over. For some reason, it was meant that van needed some more.
or we would have never stopped. We poured oil. And I went in, got some oil. I came out, and she was talking to Brother Joel. I said, "What's going on? What's wrong?" She said, "I'm taking you back to Harlem." I said, "Why?" She said, "I'm taking you back to Harlem." "Why? What's going on?" She said, "Because something's not right." I said, "Okay. You must see something." And I submitted. Poor Mother Williams, she was sitting back there. I guess you didn't have a clue, did you, Mother? Albany, man. And she told me what was going on. I still didn't have a clue. They said, "What's wrong with you?" I said, "Nothing." And they took me on back and they started talking and this and that. And the thing that really got me was when the doctor came in, after they took me through some tests, I had to do an EEG, an EKG, an MRI, and all this stuff, and taking blood, and then I had to do that thing with all the wires was in my head. I'm laying in the hospital. I said, "How did I get here? What am I doing here?" That morning I was preaching. That Saturday we had a wonderful prayer breakfast. All of a sudden, Sunday night, I'm in the hospital. What am I doing in here, Lord? Didn't understand. And they ran a new test, but the doctor came in and he introduced himself to me. And I shook his hand and said, "My name is Timothy Scott. It's nice to meet you." Yada, 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 yada. And he stood in there maybe 10 minutes and talked. And my wife told me, in 10 minutes, I introduced myself to him again. "My name is Timothy Scott." And she said, "You just introduced yourself." And I said, "No, I didn't." So long story short, after more tests and so forth, everything came back negative. Thank God. Everything came back negative. Transient global amnesia. I had a short circuit. It's a short circuit. And they let me out Tuesday night. I share that with you to tell you that God is an awesome God. So when the Lord created you if you desire.